A quick disclaimer before we get into it, this is not meant to be a guide to Luna. Do not expect this to be a comprehensive introduction to the members or the music. Rather, it's a look at the history of the group and their place in the industry. Anyway, with that aside, I do not have all the facts. Not every single detail is here. I'm sure Orbitz have much more information stored away. Every statistic used is readily available information. This video is not intended to point fingers at certain groups nor start any fan wars. I ask that you leave your opinions about the members, your opinions about the fandom, and your opinions about any other groups mentioned here out of your consideration for the video. Swear not by the moon, the fickle moon, the inconstant moon, that monthly changes in her circle orb, lest that thy love prove likewise variable. Our story starts in April of 2016 with Blockberry Creative, an entertainment company in South Korea and a subsidiary of Polaris Entertainment. I'm going with Polaris. Anyway, Blockberry is the youngest child of a very rich family, but for now, all you need to know is that they're shiny, new, and wealthy. So here's Blockberry, freshly minted with a big bank account and a blank slate. What do? In early October, just 6 months after being founded, Blockberry makes an announcement. Their first ever group is coming. 12 members, gorgeous visuals, crazy storytelling, fancy art things, and it's all coming in 18 months. Wait. 18 months? Blockberry's plan is to slowly release the group through an 18-month debut project. The group members will be revealed one by one, each with a personalized solo song and a single album, all under the Korean name Ida de Sonyo, or Girl of the Month. And if you take the first letter of each syllable, turn in a circle, and clap your hands three times, that spells Luna. Now let's get into the goods. The first member released under Luna is Heejin in October of 2016. Following Heejin, there's Hyunjin, Hassel, and Yojin, and reaching fifth member Vivi, who hasn't yet released her solo, in March of 2017. These first few members form Luna's first subunit, Luna 1/3. Except Yojin, she's too short. Just kidding, it's because she's too young, and also maybe because she's failing school. 1/3 has an airbrushed, girly theme, and their music is centered around real-life struggles like love and girlhood and being a cyborg. 1/3 puts out their debut album in March to play the early market, but sandwiched between GFriend and the debut of Pristin, the album doesn't pass the 3,000 sales mark. 1/3 releases a repackage in April, but that sells even fewer copies. In the midst of all this, Vivi has her solo debut in April, which sells more copies than both the 1/3 albums combined. So far, the solo debuts are Luna's biggest moneymakers. Moving along, we hit the summer releases. Sixth member Kim Lip debuts in late May and marks a change in Luna's visual and auditory dynamic. She's followed by Jinsol in June and Chwery in July. These three members form the second Luna subunit, Odd Eye Circle. Their concept is much more mysterious, and their music takes influence from the Western mainstream. They release an album in September, Mix and Match, and while it doesn't chart as highly as 1/3's debut, it actually sells better, finally crossing the 3,000 sales mark after the first month. Odd Eye Circle releases a repackage album in October, which does even better, dodging behind Twice and claiming the final selling spot of the month. Now, something important happens just before Odd Eye Circle releases their album, Mix 9. And boy, do I wish that Dreamcatcher had been the final time we'd have to talk about Mix 9. Nope! Luna also makes a pit stop at Mix 9. YG calls the Luna project unappealing, but Heejin and Hyunjin pass auditions, and this is when things get interesting. The girls manage to scrape up a decent amount of attention for Luna while competing on Mix 9. Heejin in particular amasses significant popularity. Hyunjin makes it into the top 18 for girls, and Heejin ranks number 4 out of all female contestants, putting her in the final lineup for the girls' team. At the end of the day, the boys' team is declared the winners, but it ends up not mattering either way. Cue the Carmen. The final group's debut is cancelled by YG, and their stock pretty much plummets. The girls return to Blockberry without a winning title, but it's more a success than a loss. The girls were able to return to an actively promoting project, and the show had brought curious attention to Luna. There's a lot more details in there, but that's kind of the gist of it. The debut train keeps rolling. In November, the next batch of Luna members come tumbling out of the oven. Ninth member Eve debuts, followed by Chu in December and Gowon in January of 2018. There's a couple fan activities here and there, as well as BlockBerry releasing a video for a day that doesn't exist, but finally, on March 30th, the final member is revealed. Olivia Hay debuts with her song Egoist, and we see the two bookend members of Luna together at last. The final four members form the last Luna subunit, YYXY. YYXY plans to release in late May, which kind of puts the fear of God in some fans, as Idol debuts at the very beginning of the month, followed by comebacks from BTS and Pristin. But it seems BlockBerry are finally learning to play the market, because YYXY drops just at the end of May, and in the midst of the heavy-hitting badass concepts, YYXY is an electropop sound with a bright concept. While there is no repackage, the album, Beauty and the Beat, sells higher than the other four subunit albums combined. And it doesn't stop there. With all 12 Pokemon finally collected, Luna releases a full group pre-debut song, Favorite, just before they're set to officially debut. 2 days before debut, Luna holds Lunabirth, a debut concert in Seoul for an audience of 3,000, where the members perform all 12 solo songs, songs from each subunit, and 5 group songs, including their debut single. August 20th, 2018. 30 music videos, all over the world, nearly 2 years worth of work, but it's finally done. After 1 year, 10 months, and 17 days, all 12 girls together at last. Luna officially debuts on August 20th, 2018, with their title track, Hi Hi. Hi Hi is a more domestic-based ColourPop concept, featuring cheer skirts, bright colors, powerful vocals from the members. The video eats over 1 million views per day, and the album sells almost 53,000 copies by the end of the year, making it the second highest selling album for a girl group debut that year. The album peaks at number 2 on the Gaon chart, and the girls promote the song on music shows for 7 weeks. It seems the 2-year-long project may have bought Luna a ticket to immediate success. Only the next comeback can tell. A month goes by. Nothing new, but hey, just had their debut, right? Then 2. Then 3. Then 4. Suddenly, it's December and no sign of Luna. And then the year is over. No sign of Luna. After getting content practically on a monthly basis for nearly 2 years, it feels a bit strange to not be hearing from them for so long. In fact, this particular hiatus lasts exactly half a year, and to say fans get antsy is an understatement. Finally, in February, a teaser hits, confirming the upcoming comeback, Butterfly. Celebrations. After 6 months of waiting, Luna has a comeback. Butterfly is the lead single of their repackaged debut album, Multiply Multiply. The comeback is a reverse from the bright pop of Hi Hi, this time aiming at a different part of the mainstream, incorporating trendy bass and synth, powerful dancing, and the ever-popular beat drop. The concept explores a different side of femininity, and the comeback is widely celebrated in the fandom. The song hits strongest in the international market, charting at 6 on Billboard's World Digital Songs. Finally, it looks like Luna has a shot at a first win. The group promotes the comeback for 6 weeks, and the fanbase sees expansion into the domestic market as well as the international. Butterfly, however, doesn't lead to the first win fans think it will. Domestically, things take a turn for the worse. Despite all the hype, the repackage album doesn't sell anywhere near their first, and once it drops off the charts, the era is basically over. This marks a trend in the beginning schism between the international popularity Luna is experiencing within their own fandom and the actual domestic results of their success. But it's still a new year. There's always next comeback, right? BlockBerry releases a few teasers, hinting at a potential summer comeback, and then radio silence. Complete and utter vacancy. Right as it seemed a comeback was about to be born, nothing comes out of BlockBerry. The months begin passing by. The new comeback season kicks in, and groups start rolling in the revenue, and no sign of Luna. Summer ends, and fall begins. Boom. News turns up in the fall. Luna's seemingly endless well of funds has run dry, and BlockBerry Creative is in debt. Everything goes to hell in a handbasket. The news sparks disbandment rumors, and fear takes everything from there. The fans trend hashtag SaveLuna on Twitter, and a few GoFundMes are set up, but they go nowhere. The fanbase goes crazy, BlockBerry drops dormant, and Luna falls completely silent. The moon's an errant thief, and her pale fire she snatches from the sun. So what happened? Let's take a look at the exterior factors first. This is side one to our story. Let's take it back even before the beginning of BlockBerry Creative. It all begins with an arms trade company called Ilkwang Group. Ilkwang Group is a wealthy South Korean corporation that manufactures training programs for the Korean military and primarily deals in the military arms trade. In 2006, Ilkwang gives birth to Polaris Entertainment. And that might seem strange, but it's not unusual for corporations to establish footholds in many industries. There's money to be made in the music industry, as well as a lot of influence. In 2016, Polaris gives birth to Ilkwang's grandchild, BlockBerry Creative. While the Luna Project was a creative way to bring in fans, it was also expensive. Extremely expensive. All in all, the pre-debut project cost nearly $9 million. BlockBerry belongs to Ilkwang, who is very wealthy, but even the beginnings of Luna's project have notable strain. Plans for Luna are in action as early as 2014, with songs, designs, and promotions already prepared, before BlockBerry even exists, and that content that will eventually become Luna is stored up in Polaris. In all likelihood, Luna may have actually originally been a Polaris group. And then, in March of 2015, an ongoing investigation into the Korean arms industry reveals a trail of corruption leading back to Ilkwang. The South Korean government raids the office, and the CEO of Ilkwang is arrested for fraud and temporarily puts the whole company, Polaris included, on ice. He's also accused of sexual predation, but we're not going to get into that this time. After things start to thaw out, Ilkwang tries to find themselves a new CEO, but the impact of the investigation is crippling. Both companies are hit hard in the wallet. After a year, they decide to establish a subsidiary, BlockBerry Creative, and all plans for the Luna Project are rehoused over there. Either BlockBerry is a planned subsidiary now bruised from the events of 2015, or BlockBerry pops up in a desperate bid to continue the new project without having Polaris's name stapled to it. Either way, there's less money in the game than originally planned, and the project bites off more than it can chew. After One Third's albums sell low, BlockBerry scales back the expenses for the next batch of debuts. No more overseas photo shoots, no more overly elaborate sets. Right around Odd Eye Circle, BlockBerry goes through another series of changes. During the first half of the project, BlockBerry's main distributor is Stone Music, but after Jinsoul's debut, they switch over to Vlending. This switch shows an improvement in album sales, but causes company confusion and budget strain, messing with the project's timeline. When Luna debuts in 2018, the album does well, but not nearly well enough to pay off the insane debut cost. After Hi-Hi, BlockBerry switches their distribution yet again, this time to KakaoM. And we've talked about KakaoM before, but they seem particularly disliked by parts of the fandom due to a lot of preventable mistakes during Butterfly's promotions, including but not limited to the album being unavailable for purchase on iTunes, listed under the wrong name on Spotify, and physically unbuyable due to a massive printing shortage. It's important to point out, KakaoM is not solely responsible for the album shortage. Prints can be done by separate third-party companies, but regardless, something goes majorly wrong in the planning process and albums run out. Luna albums become notoriously hard to purchase, and alongside all these other mistakes, problems arise with Mnet distribution and Billboard presence dips. Out on the promotional stage, Luna doesn't take home a win, so chances of new sponsors are slim to none. And here's where it gets serious. At this point, Polaris and BlockBerry have borrowed a lot from various patrons around the industry, and many of them want their money back. One of their largest debts goes to Japanese IT company Donuts, and I'm not making that up, their name literally is Donuts. Polaris borrowed 400 million won from Donuts in 2017, and only returned about 40 million of it. Donuts also invested 3.5 billion won into Luna in exchange for Polaris to schedule appearances from all members on Donuts' broadcasting app for a live streaming event. In reality, only one member shows up. So Donuts files a lawsuit against Polaris to return the investment, and another under criminal charges for making off with the money. failing to pay off debts or uphold contracts, Polaris is hit with two massive lawsuits, and the court orders them to pay back the remaining 360 million won. The money runs out, BlockBerry is put on ice, and the Luna project goes back underground. It is the very error of the moon. She comes more nearer Earth than she was wont, and makes men mad. Now we're going to take a look at the inside, the second side to the story, going way back to the foundation of Luna. Enter stage right, Jaden Jung. He's a songwriter and a producer, and he's Luna's creative director. Some fans consider him the god of the Luniverse. Others call him Luna's deadbeat dad. Before coming into business with BlockBerry, Jaden has previously worked with other K-pop groups. He makes his rounds through the K-pop world, stopping by JYP with Miss A, Woollim, and eventually making his way to Polaris. While working with Woollim, he serves as the primary director behind the girl group Lovelies. His big plan? Give the members individual solos leading up to their debut as a group. Sound familiar? This is also an early version of Jaden's idea for a shadow group, which roughly means he wants them to promote their music as a secret underground artist without the use of regular K-pop promotional institutions.
And in 2010, I figured out invisibility.
He says he wants them to be the most unknown female girl group. Unfortunately, being unknown doesn't really pay well. After a couple years batting around as a Laylow group, the cash stops flowing, and Jaden leaves the company, delaying Lovely's debut and leaving them to restart from scratch. He couch hops his way over to Polaris, where he becomes a producer for Ladies Code. Jaden sets about creating a musical anthology to reestablish the group and fanbase after the deaths of two members in a car accident. The series is called The Healing Trilogy and plans to have three albums. The first album, Mystery, is released in early 2016, and the second, Stranger, is released later in the fall. The third album is scheduled to release in 2017, but an entire year passes without the release from Ladies Code. In early 2018, member Ashley is forced to admit that the third album has been cancelled, and fans quickly discover that Jaden has ceased his partnership with Ladies Code.
A lot of our Lovelies and fans are expecting a comeback, but unfortunately it is not a comeback. It is our showcase that's held on our fifth year anniversary, which is March 7th. And I think we're going to put an end to this trio, the album that we said that we were going to do. So instead of that, we're going to do something new. So this is the last part of our trilogy.
It's widely believed that the money sectioned out to fund the trilogy was diverted into Jaden's new project with BlockBerry. Around You, one of the songs from the unreleased third album, will eventually become Hyunjin's debut song under Luna. Two-thirds of the way through the Healing Trilogy, Jaden packs up his bags and leaves, taking the remaining songs with him and leaving Ladies Code behind. In fact, Jaden might have planned to leave the trilogy unfinished before he even signed on. Jaden meanders his way down the Polaris family tree as early as 2014, where the first stirrings of the Luna project can be found. He signs on with BlockBerry when they've just come out of the womb, blue-eyed and big-brained. Jaden and BlockBerry set about implementing the solo song concept with their new group. Jaden has a very specific vision in mind for Luna. He wants to promote them as an underground group, a secret art movement led by guerrilla releases without conforming to the usual K-pop institutions, specifically music shows and idol promotions. All in all, it sounds like a cool underdog story. In reality, it's a big risk with a very small payoff range. Remember, Jaden also planned for Lovelies to be the most unknown female girl group, and had the same underground vision for his previous projects. BlockBerry, on the other hand, is a company that needs to fulfill a profit margin. On top of that, the sheer number of different writers alone makes browsing the Luna discography a bit dizzying. Some songs seem straight up airlifted out of other groups' albums and dropped into Luna's, and in some cases they are. While the idea of the solo songs was that they're built to suit each member, certain songs were originally written for other singers, and just brought with Jaden when he left project after project. While it's no question Luna absolutely made their solo songs theirs and hit their debuts out of the park, to this day, we don't know just how many Luna songs were originally intended for other artists. Even some of Luna's other frequent writers, such as Monotree, joke about Jaden being hard to work with. During the debut project, Jaden begins putting stress on the girls themselves, demanding that 16-year-old Olivia Hay lose weight, pressuring Jinsol into bleaching her hair, giving her scalp damage and migraines, and forcing the girls to conform to his ideal Shadow Project standards, even at the cost of mental and physical health. DigiPetty, the video company behind many of Luna's videos, also calls him out for being overly restrictive and demanding of the resources and the girls. By the time we reach High High, no one can really tell for sure what the hell Luna is going to look like. So when they officially debut, some fans call High High disappointing, claiming that the debut project built Luna up to be more than just one more cute concept in cheer uniforms. Some discourage the sound and concept, claiming Luna to be above this kind of release. When you take a look at Luna's releases, however, High High isn't actually that far off from a lot of what Luna promotes. On top of that, it sells well, which is probably the goal of producing such a radio-friendly debut. The tensions rise between Jaden and Blockberry, two sides playing tug-of-war with Luna. Where Jaden is a creative director who wants to promote his artistic vision,
is art!
I call it bold and brash.
More like belongs in the trap.
Blockberry is still a company, and they have to balance the expectations of consumers, the careers of 12 idols, and the fact that they shot themselves in the foot quite frequently during the last few years. Despite the sales from High High and Butterfly, Blockberry is still juggling looming debt. In a bid to try and reestablish cash flow, Blockberry steps away from the Lunaverse and tries to reorient the group around their music and promotions. Conflict between Blockberry and Jaden ensues. In response, Jaden states he scrapped an entire ballad album for Luna's future comeback. As I'm not involved in the fandom, I don't know exactly what the fandom opinion on Jaden is, but my research showed some heartbroken fans and even several stressed members of Luna. Finally, the money runs dry. The capital borrowed to support Luna has not been paid back. Polaris falls under lawsuit, and Luna goes dormant. In the midst of this, Jaden and Blockberry split. He walks off the set of Luna, gone.
4 happy days bring in another moon. But oh, methinks, how slow this old moon wanes.
Now let's take a look at a third party in the story, the fans. In most cases, companies are the primary players, and fans are usually the last actor in the industry. But Luna's fanbase is unusually involved in their group's narrative. In the deep, silent period of Luna's hiatus, the fans are left alone with their own hopes and fears, and each other. They've got 2 albums, a dozen solo albums, and no foreseeable future of Luna's promotions. Well, damn it, if you want something done right, you gotta do it yourself! Taking a page out of Kony 2012, the Luna fanbase makes a plan to hit the internet with wall-to-wall Luna advertisement. While there have been active fan promotions from Orbitz since 2016, this is a whole different level of, dedication. Drop whatever you're doing, say goodbye to your loved ones, stop rewatching Luna TV for the 87th time in a row today, and get busy. Merch promos, spamming the girls' videos under every tweet or post, meme after meme after meme. I'm sure everybody and their dead mother has heard the words, Stan Luna.
Stan Luna.
At this point, everyone has had their doorbells rung by Orbitz offering you their Lord and Savior. One of the long-lasting barriers to Luna's success is the air of hashtag not like the other girls that surrounds them. We can probably say this stems from Jaden's conception of Luna as a shadow group known only to those daring enough to accept them. For a long time, Luna's marketing and industry narrative thrived on the idea of being either on the inside or the outside, which can drive people away since it comes off as pretentious or selective. The self-aggrandizing done by Jaden and some of the louder parts of the fanbase damaged Luna's ability to grow their audience. So when those same hashtag not like other girls fans came knocking on everyone's door to advertise Luna, doesn't look so good. Now every fandom is scummy fans. In fact, Maybe If You'd Stand Blank shows up in just about every fanbase with active online presence. Some of the Stan Luna memes are very much fake, others definitely not. But it doesn't really matter either way. Was Stan Luna a success? Yes and no. It certainly got word around. People knew the name Luna on pain of death, and you'll hear tales from people who joined the fandom purely thanks to the Stan Luna meme. But what it largely did was brand the fanbase as desperate, invasive, or downright tasteless at times. And the last thing the story needs right now is more conflict. One of the biggest concerns at the time is the legality surrounding the Lunaverse. Roughly speaking, the Lunaverse is the narrative story of Luna, the lore and universe that connects all the music videos, members, and songs together. As Jaden is the artistic creator of the Lunaverse, there was a fear that Jaden could walk away and take the Luna project with him. This is generally not how production contracts work.
Typically, if a project has been greenlit for a production phase, the company has officially bought the rights to the project and maintains control over the project's future. This can seem pretty vampiric, but it's designed to give companies insurance. Once a project is in the works, you're not talking about the paychecks of three faceless executives and one artistic director. You're also including the capital from expecting consumers and the careers of any performing parties. In a case like this, it prevents creators from walking off the lot, taking everything of value with them as they go. BlackBerry still owns the rights to the music, music videos, designs, and promotional content, which leads me to believe that BlackBerry got custody of the Lunaverse in the divorce. However, Jaden has left contracts before, and last time he brought the residual material to BlackBerry and gave it to Luna. Maybe he'll do the same this time. Let's take a look at what the Lunaverse actually is as a unit of storytelling and narrative. Boiled down, the Lunaverse isn't really a solid story product. The Lunaverse is largely a series of loosely linked, hinted at ideas. It's actually a smart marketing tactic. The Lunaverse is a perfect machine for practically endless fan engagement. Jaden has created a space within the Luna dynamic that always intrigues hungry fans without ever having to fully deliver. In fact, despite the marketing and branding of the group as Girl of the Month, the members don't even have respective months. Heejin debuts in October, okay, so maybe she's the October girl, but both Hassel and Shu have December debuts, and the company never confirmed if any specific girl represents any specific month, even years after debut. At this point, the closest connection Luna has to the concept of months is just having 12 members. It's also important to note that we may never know how many other pieces of lore were meant to come out. At this point, some even fear the lore will go unfinished forever. Well, in September, the Luna radar starts to ping again, and rumors of a comeback begin rising. However, it just turns out to be BlackBerry advertising Orbit 2.0, the second round of their official pay-to-enter fan club. So no, no comeback, but enjoy a new photo shoot and some stickers. Things get worse in November. Jaden Jeong sits down for an interview where he talks about his new clients, boy group Only One Of. Fans take issue with the way Jaden talks about his new group, as he says, quote, "They work harder because they have a genuine attachment to the music, which many fans believe is an indirect slight at his past groups. The Luna members were under strict control while Jaden was acting director and weren't allowed to participate in the musical process despite some of them being trained in songwriting, so this dig feels especially hypocritical." Let's talk about another side of the fans for a moment. Orbits act as one of the largest promotional organs for Luna. The Luna fandom is largely international and even then still niche. Due to the smaller size of the fandom, the mishaps with promotions, and the overall fear hanging over Luna, the fanbase develops a strong advertising identity. Luna is one of the most fan-promoted groups active right now. Jaden's plan to make Luna an unknown shadow group had the opposite effect. The whole pre-debut project brought Luna and their fans really, really close together. Luna's blackout here proves something very interesting about the Luna narrative. When all else fails and everything falls apart, the fans carry the group. This is actually true of a lot of groups, but Luna's fanbase is still majority international, not domestic. In Luna's absence, the fanbase is keeping them going across the curvature of the Earth. In fact, the fans are one of the major forces keeping Hope alive during this hiatus. Besides the meme explosion, the fans put up constant outpouring of love for the girls and the music. Armed with only a few dance covers and minute-long updates in the form of Luna TV, the fans keep up an active stream of Luna content during the blackout. And it tells the market something else. Luna doesn't belong to a bunch of faceless executives or a shadow market or one artistic ego. Luna belongs to the fans who love them. Finally, after 10 months of silence, the darkness breaks.
On December 13th, Luna releases a fan-dedicated single, 365. Or maybe it's 365, I don't exactly know. The song speaks directly to the fanbase, thanking them for waiting and promising a whole year of success together. It's also the first group single not written by Jaden Jeong. The song debuts at the top of the US World Digital Songs chart and tells the world something the fans have been longing to hear. Luna is coming.
Therefore the moon, the governess of floods, pale in her anger, washes all the air. And through this distemperature we see the seasons alter. Hoary-headed frosts fall in the fresh lap of the crimson rose. A day after the release of 365, a teaser drops. Now, at this point, people are starting to wise up. Not everyone immediately trusts that this is a for sure sign of a comeback. After all, isn't there still that lawsuit thing to worry about? The year closes out with no comeback, but a few days into the new year, BlockBerry releases a new statement. BlockBerry announces on January 8th that member Hostel will be taking a hiatus due to diagnosed anxiety, and she won't be involved in any upcoming promotions while she seeks treatment. Just a day after this announcement, a second trailer goes live, this time with a date on the end. Okay, BlockBerry, maybe you're onto something, but it's gonna take more than that to make up for the blackout. Well, fine. 2 weeks later, third teaser. That does it. It's Luna time. But did you think that was it? A few days later, a Forbes article goes viral on Twitter. Luna's new album is a collaborative effort between BlockBerry and Lee Soo-man. Lee Soo-man is the founder and executive producer of SM Entertainment, the most powerful company in K-pop. He's one of the most influential and important figures in the industry. And as his first project outside of SM Entertainment, he's in collaboration with Luna for their newest album. And you might ask yourself, what powerful marketing technique convinced him to invest in Luna? Boom. The word is out. Luna is having a comeback. And now they have an industry titan on their side. Finally, it's time. February 5th, 2020. I'm so bad. Luna has their second comeback, So What, alongside their third album, Hash. New image, new sound, new message. Burn yourself. Luna's still here, and some believe that the comeback is a direct response to the mess of 2019, featuring the image of the burning moon and the phrase, "Do not accept the fate of the moon," which could mean Luna moving past Jaden's stronghold over the project. The music video makes a collective 1.9 million views in its first 24 hours, and the album hits number 4 on Billboard's World Albums chart, punctuated by their best sales week in America to date. It also becomes Luna's best-selling album on Hanteo, hitting 25,700 sales in the first month alone. The international reception is really welcome, for sure, but Luna absolutely cannot slip up here and become a purely Western import. It's February, first popular selling season of the year, which means as many groups as possible are vying for attention, and the industry is hungry. What Luna really needs is positive Korean reception to finally put them on the map back home. Boom. The album debuts at number 2 on the Gaon chart and sells over 79,000 copies in the first month, making it Luna's best-selling album as of the making of this video. And despite heavy competition, it gives Luna what no other era could, a first win. On March 12th, M Countdown awarded Luna their first win for So What.
저희가 1년 동안 앨범을 준비하면서 되게 두려움이 많았는데 이번 상을 타고 되게 저희 곡 메시지처럼 변화를 두려워하지 않고 전진할 수 있을 것 같아요. 여러분 너무 감사합니다.
Finally, after all that, solid proof that Luna isn't going anywhere. No, they're not in the clear yet. There's still a ton of money issues that haven't seen clean ends, damage remaining from the Jaden debacle, and the road ahead is long and uphill both ways. But after looking at all this research and spending 15 goddamn pages recording this video, I can't help but feel like, right now, they're exactly where they're supposed to be. That's all from me this time. Signing off.